presidential election 2019.
Today we are here with the prominent businessman Rohan Pallewatta, the presidential candidate of the National Development Front. Why did you decide on contesting the presidential election?
Well, a good question. As an entrepreneur, I would have easily retired as a reputed entrepreneur. But whatever we do as an entrepreneur, this is in the micro environment. And the macro environment that you belong to is controlled by a set of politicians. So whatever that we do in the micro has a bearing, has an effect in the activities that is taking place in the macro. So then the macro is mismanaged, naturally, the people in the micro who are in business or whatever field that they belong to, they have an issue in managing their own affairs. So that is when there comes a time that you have to challenge the macro and take the reins of the macro into your own hands if you have to manage it correctly. So over the past 71 years, we have seen, if you take all the international indicators, this country has not progressed. It has declined day by day and it has come to a state, a deadlock situation as at now. So as a person with a reasonable consciousness and a nationalistic mind, you cannot stay in the background and believe that some miracle would happen and things would change by an accident. It will never change by an accident. It is only through the effort of some people, few individuals, who will continue to fight this system that we can establish a better country. So it is with these bona fide intentions that I came forward to contest the presidency.
Do you believe you can be a decisive factor at the election?
I think already I have become, because there are 35 candidates, but I think I am among the, I mean, if you take four serious candidates, I am among the four serious candidates at the moment.
As a leading businessman in the country, what prompted you to enter politics?
Well, as I said earlier, as a businessman, of course, I would have enjoyed, I should have enjoyed my comfort zone. You know, I'm a very peace-loving person. But then, as I said, if you can rest on what you have earned, and if you can enjoy the luxuries of what you have so tirelessly earned for yourself, and forget your duties towards the country, and expect that everything will fall in line by an accident. So that was against my consciousness. So that is why, once again, I reiterate for the reason for me to come out and enter into politics, knowing that I'm getting into a morass, knowing that I'm going to put myself in uneasiness. But then I'm ready to forego all that. I'm ready to forego my mental peace for the sake of the people of this country and for the sake of my country.
What do you think is the most crucial aspect in the country that needs immediate change?
Well, the immediate attention should be, because even at the very outset, I said 3 years prior, because now once the presidential election is declared, we always had about 15 to 20 candidates. But this time, it is the most number of candidates, that is 35. But in the history of Sri Lankan politics, if any person has come out and pronounced loud and clear that he is going to challenge this system and going to contest for the presidency 3 years prior to the presidential election, let me very humbly say that it was myself. So there is a difference between candidates coming at the 11th hour, a candidate coming 3 years three years prior and pronouncing it loud and clear. Yeah, the immediate change that I intend bringing is because when I came out to challenge the system 3 years ago, I clearly mentioned that there is an issue of repaying our debts. So the leadership is not about seeing the danger that is there awaiting to happen tomorrow, but seeing it much in advance. So the right now the government is facing an issue, that is to pay the debt installments, they have to get into debt. So this is now, it has become a debt crisis. So I predicted it 3 years prior to what is happening today. So my solution would be, right now, what we need, the priority should be to fix the economy. or try, rather come out of the deadlock situation of the economy. In order to do that, we need, what I suggest is that we need about $10 billion within a, as foreign direct investment, as a very short span of time. That is about within 12 months, we need about $10 billion. And on my part, as a serious presidential candidate, I have traveled the world, I have spoken to the British government, I have spoken to some Japanese counterparts, and then I have spoken to the King of Ras Al Khaimah. And then they have pledged up to $4 billion to be invested in Sri Lanka. And mind you, I have done all this not even being in a provincial council or a Pradeshiya Sabha. This is in my private capacity. So to get this foreign direct investment in the capacity of the head of state would be a walk through the garden, and we can get the necessary funds for sure.
What is your personal opinion of the country's tax policies?
Well, tax policies, one thing is they are so complicated. Most of the people do not understand what the taxes that they pay, especially the corporates. And also there are so much indirect taxes, especially in the, you know, consumer goods. I was in Tokyo, in Melbourne and London during the past few weeks. When you walk into a supermarket and when you pay for your food items, you realize that in Sri Lanka, the food items are twice as that of these developed countries. And they are paying that amount for food with their highest, you know, high scale salaries. But in Sri Lanka, for people to pay that amount to your food items is a huge issue to them, because they cannot afford. So that is why people go to the supermarket and sometimes looking at the vegetables, whether to buy 500 grams or 100 grams, they are thinking 10 or 100 times. So this is the amount of poverty. I mean, poverty is everywhere, right, at different levels. So the reason that the food items are at that price is because there is 70% indirect government taxes in the food items. So people might tell me, I'm trying to reduce that 70%, right? Where do we, I mean, the income that the government will lose, where am I going to find it? Well, my proposition is, if you go to Malaysia or if you go to Thailand, the prices of the food items prevalent 10 years ago, it is the same today, or sometimes even less. Why do they do that? Because in order to manufacture something, we need labor, we need people, and we have to keep our salary scales at a reasonable level. When the food items cannot be afforded, every year people will agitate for increasing of salaries. When the salaries are increased, as it is happening in Sri Lanka, because when the workers cannot even afford the food with the salaries that they get, naturally they have to agitate. And when that happens, the cost of production goes up. And when the cost of production goes up, you cannot compete in international trade with your product. So this is a vicious cycle which we have to find answers. So regarding the tax policy, mainly I would say, I would be taking action within a very short period of time to remove these indirect taxes from consumer goods.
Do you believe Sri Lanka will ever be able to pay off the debt that has accumulated? And if it's a possibility, how best do you think it can be addressed?
Well, the government will have to take a policy decision as to what is the percentage of debt that we are going to entertain in this country. For example, right now it is, I think, 87% of the GDP. So as to the extent that we are going to reduce it, are we going to make it 40% of the, you know, our GDP or 30%? It's a matter of policy decision for the government to take. So the debt repayment, you know, what I'm talking about is when the interest rate is very high, when the interest rate is commercial rates that we pay, and that is the biggest burden. Because now, I mean, there are certain other sources where we can obtain loans at much reasonable, you know, amount. For example, recently for the light railway, we received 1.7 billion from Japan. But we have a grace period of 12 years, and the amount of interest that we have to pay is 0.1, right? For some of the loans, we are paying about 7%. That is my grievance, that is my complaint as a citizen, right? So that is why it is not the debt alone, but the interest rates that we pay is the issue right now.
Are you certain that you won't pull out of the presidential race closer to the 16th of November?
Well, I have been in the race for the past 3 years, so there is no reason for me to pull out at the 11th hour. Unless there is a viable coalition and unless there is a call upon me to make a sacrifice, but only to for a viable, you know, coalition that is also to fulfill the aspirations of the people.
Do you believe educational qualifications are vital for a country's president and why?
Well, my answer to that question is, I should say that the president is elected as the executive by the direct mandate of the people. And the legislature, once again, they receive a different mandate that is also direct from the people. So I believe when the executive receives a direct mandate from the people, its responsibility directly is to the people of the country. So to come out with, you know, various policies and all that is the role of the legislature. And the role of the president is to supervise the policies that is coming from the legislature. So in order to do that supervision, he should have a fair knowledge of the maybe transportation, education, every area. Not that he should be an expert on every field, but he should have a fair knowledge to understand, right? Because when Aristotle was questioned as to who should be the leader of a state, he said it should be a philosopher, right? So what he meant was a person who can have a holistic view of any issue of a country. So sometimes, although you may have all the qualifications, of course I have my doctorate from the University of Bolton, but then not necessarily. Sometimes there might be a person who has educated himself from the society and he might have a holistic view than a person who's having a paper qualification. So you cannot say exactly that you should have these kind of qualifications, but it is better to have some criteria to assess the knowledge of the person whom you are trying to elect as the leader of the country.
Can corruption be eliminated entirely in a country practically?
Well, corruption, when it is deeply rooted, it is not an easy task. You can't do it overnight. But that does not prevent the will, the political will, to eliminate it completely. For example, the example should come from the top. One of our research findings point out that if you reduce the corruption at the government procurement level, the economy of Sri Lanka will grow by 2%. So that is the level of corruption that we have. So what we intend doing is to introduce technology like the blockchain so that every transaction will be monitored through a central blockchain and it will be transparent. So that no one can, because no transaction taking outside the blockchain will be a valid transaction in this country. Right? So that way we can introduce technology to minimize or to curb or stop corruption that is prevalent in the country. And also we intend, going a step further. Countries like Dubai are already, they have already implemented what we propose for government expenditure, right? Of course, we have the right to information bill, but we know the hassle when you try to get some information, the hassle that one has to go through. So since the mobile phone is available, Most of our people are having smartphones, and I think mobile penetration is about 140% of our country. So if we can get this device, you can have an app or something where every day a person who's interested can log in and see what was the government income and what was the government expenditure and how did they spend that. So people should not be left in the dark as to the loans or whatever, because they are buying these at the cost of the people, because people are responsible at the end of the day. It is not the government alone. It is the people of the country that are responsible in repaying these debts, right? So the people have the right to know as to which source that they obtained from, at which interest rate, and how that money was spent on which project. They have the right to know. So therefore, why not make it available in a device like mobile phone? Yeah.
Do you believe Sri Lanka can someday reach the status of a developed nation?
Of course, with the right thinking and right management, I do not think it is a very distant dream. Because now we have like the mineral sands, we have the phosphate, we have the graphite, you know, three most important minerals in the world. But we are just selling in raw form without adding any value. I know there are companies who came to Sri Lanka proposing to add value in this country. But because of the rampant corruption that is taking place and the amount of commissions that is demanded by the line ministries, these investors came and they went. So we are in the loop with them right now, and they are ready to come back and invest. These three projects alone can jumpstart the economy of Sri Lanka. And our target is within a very short period. People say it's too ambitious, but we are confident. Within a very short period, we can go from 4,000 per capita to 10,000 per capita with all the resources that we have. Because if Sri Lanka cannot be a developed country, I do not think any country in the world can be a developed country for that matter.
What is your take on the executive presidency? Should it remain or be abolished?
Well, my popular view is that it should be abolished. But I am not taking the popular view, because when I first raised my hand to contest for the presidency, first I got hold of this document, which is our manifesto. This is the national blueprint, way forward for the country. And this was designed not by myself, of course, it was by Professor Deheragoda and a team of intellectuals. And when I, you know, went through this back and forth, I scanned this in my mind back and forth. It is only when I was confident that I can implement what is written here that I raised my hand to contest for the presidency. So when I was thinking whether this is implementable, of course, you need some power and authority to make it a reality. So I was, of course, in my mind, I thought that I would need executive powers of a president to implement this program. So I am personally for the executive presidency to remain.
Thank you very much for your time, and we wish you all the best in all your future endeavors leading up to the election.
Thank you so much for your time.